Hello again, guys. How's it going? So I want to continue here and talk about the deity of Christ, okay, or the divine nature of Christ, and some evidences for the deity of Christ in Scripture. I've already made a video prior to this on the person and natures of Christ, how Christ is a singular divine person with dual natures, a divine nature and a human nature. And so we're going to go more into the deity of Christ, and this is going to be a long study with multiple parts, and I'm really glad to get started into this. And today I'm just going to look at maybe six verses or passages or so, and I haven't done a lot of preparation for this, but I've had these notes for a while, and basically what I did is I looked at the verses that I wanted to use. And I went to Bible Hub, and I found some of the better commentaries that I could find that made some good points. And even as I go through this, even once I get to the point where I say, okay, I'm kind of done with the deity of Christ, I've went over all the parts that I wanted to go over, there's still going to be more refining and stuff to do in the future. And I'm not going to answer a lot of responses that people who deny the Trinity or people who deny the deity of Christ will, how they'll interpret these verses and stuff. I'm just kind of giving you the positive, trying to tell you like what these verses are saying, and make note of these so you'll be thinking about these, and hopefully you'll recognize these, remember these verses, these evidences. If someone asks you, you know, is Jesus God, this is some things that you could point them to. So, I want to start with how Jews acknowledged that Jesus claimed to be God. Okay, so we're going to see how Jesus claimed to be God pretty much explicitly in some passages, and also how the Jews claimed that Jesus claimed to be God. Okay, Jews acknowledged that Jesus claimed to be God. And so first we'll start off with the Jews acknowledge Jesus claimed to be God, and we'll look at John chapter 5, verse 17 and 18. And it says, "But Jesus answered them, My Father worketh hitherto, and I work. Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God." Okay. So they said that he broke the Sabbath, and that because he said that God was his Father, he was making himself equal to God. Okay, what Jesus said was, "My Father worketh hitherto, and I work." Okay, so John chapter 5, verse 17 and 18. Okay. Maybe I'll put a little box around this. So these are going to be the verses that you'll want to remember, look at. And basically, I guess I'm going to put the quote that Jesus said, "My Father worketh hitherto, okay, and I work." Now, I'm going to see what this commentary that I have here says about this. Some of the stuff I kind of wrote myself too, but the Jews were upset that Jesus healed someone and forgave their sins on the Sabbath day. Jesus responded by saying that God is always at work and equates himself equal with God. Okay. Even saying that God is at work on the Sabbath day, God never ceases to work, and therefore Jesus never ceases to work as well. God never ceases working, but as to burn is the property of fire, and to be cold is the property of snow, thus also is work the property of God, and much the more, inasmuch as he is the origin of action for all others. Okay. And he was speaking of my father. So he's speaking of one of the persons in the Godhead. My Father worketh hitherto, and I work. The Son also is equal with the Father. Okay, and that they never cease their divine work. Okay, the rest on the seventh day. Okay, in the beginning at the creation, the rest on the seventh day was the completion of the works of creation. Okay, this is stated emphatically in Genesis chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. It was not, and it could not be, a cessation in divine work or in the flow of divine energy. Okay, so God never ceases in His divine work. Okay, the Father never ceases, the Son never ceases. Okay, and also the Holy Spirit never ceases as well. But here Jesus is saying He never ceases, just like the Father never ceases in His divine work, neither does Jesus, the Son. Okay, and so therefore He said, I'm equal with my Father in deity, and the Jews saw that as well, okay, and they acknowledged that that was what Jesus meant. They charged Him with blasphemy, and so, you know, when He said, my Father, He was saying that He is the Son of the Father. So if you say, you know, if you say that someone's my Father, then you're saying that, you know, you're their Son. Okay. And of course there could be different senses and everything, but since He's talking about the work that the Father never ceases to do, then He is saying, you know, in nature, that He is divine just like the Father. Okay, now we'll look at the next one. We're talking about how Jews acknowledge that Jesus claimed to be God. So this is what Jesus said, but after He said this, the Jews acknowledged that what He was saying was that He was equal with God. Okay, in His deity. Now let's look at John chapter 8, verse 58 and 59. I should write what Jesus says in red marker. I could do that, but I'm kind of worried about how it's going to be seen. It's probably hard to read as it is. John chapter 8, verse 58 and 59, Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. They took up stones to cast at Him. But Jesus hid Himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. And this is something that Jesus said that I'm sure that a lot of people who have ever, you know, studied the Bible, you know, we think of this a lot. Before Abraham was, I am. Okay. Before Abraham was. I am. And a lot of these, in some of these verses, maybe a lot of them, I'm going to go over and look at different aspects of them too, okay? If we wanted to focus on just the pre-existence of Christ, and I mean, this kind of intertwines, and I'm going to go over different things, you know, the dual natures, the divine and the human and stuff, you know, I could be talking about both of them kind of at the same time, go back and forth, use different the same verses to say different things about them. But, you know, this proves the pre-existence of Christ, that He was pre-existent, you know, and we can go and see where He's pre-existent before creation, and therefore, because of that, He's also equal with the Father, and He's also divine. But I'm just going to read what this says here. Okay, I am, the expression I am, what He says at the end of this. Before Abraham was, I am. That's what Jesus said. When He said, I am, the expression I am, though in the present tense, I am, present, is clearly designed to refer to a past time. Okay, even though He's using I am, which would mean in the present, He is referring to a past time, because He's saying before Abraham was, I am. Okay, before Abraham existed, I am. You know, we would think before Abraham existed, I was, okay, I was before Him. He's saying, I am. He's using the present tense. Thus in Psalm 90, chapter 2, from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Applied to God, it denotes continued existence without respect to time, so far as he is concerned. We divide time into the past, the present, and the future. The expression applied to God denotes that he does not measure his existence in this manner, but that the word by which we express the present denotes his continued and unchanging existence. Hence, he assumes it as his name, I Am, and I Am that I Am. Exodus chapter 3, verse 14. Compare Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6, and Isaiah chapter 47, verse 8. There is a remarkable similarity between the expression employed by Jesus, the Son, in this place, and that used in Exodus to denote the name of God. The manner in which Jesus used it would strikingly suggest the application of the same language to God. The question here was about his preexistence. The objection of the Jews was that he was not 50 years old and could not, therefore, have seen Abraham. Jesus replied to that he existed before Abraham. As in his human nature, he was not yet 50 years old and could not, as a man, have existed before Abraham, this declaration must be referred to another nature. And the passage proves that, while he was a man, he was also endowed with another nature existing before Abraham, and to which he applied the term, familiar to the Jews as expressive of the existence of God, I Am. And this declaration corresponds to the affirmation of John chapter 1 and John chapter 1, verse 1, that he was in the beginning with God and was God. He is the I Am, present equally in the human, was and is to come. This affirmation of Jesus is one of the proofs on which John relies to prove that he was the Messiah, in John chapter 20, verse 31, to establish which was the design of this book. Okay, to establish the proof that Jesus was the Messiah. Okay. And that's that. Okay, so this one's obviously one that should be pretty easy to see, that Jesus had a divine nature. There's no way in his human nature that he existed before Abraham. Obviously not. So he has another nature that existed before Abraham. And that would be divine. Okay. So that's a really good verse. These all are, really, and I hope that you'll remember these. And I know that I'll be meditating on these and just going over making this video is helping me. So the next one, and these are, again, this is under the category that the Jews acknowledged that Jesus claimed to be God. So after he said, before Abraham I was, then the Jews took up stones to be cast at him. Okay, they wanted to stone him because of what he said. Okay. So, the next one is John chapter 10. And notice a lot of these are in John, but there's proof for the deity of Christ all over Scripture. John is an awesome book. Gospel of John. Of course, all of them are. But let's see. Now, John chapter 10, verse 30 through 33. Hope this is still recording me talking. Hate to have to redo this, even though that happens a lot. Let's see. John chapter 10, verse 30 through 33. I and my Father are one. Bam. Okay, then Jews took up stones again to stone him. Jesus answered them, many good works have I shewed you from my Father. For which of those works do you stone me? The Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, because that thou, being a man, makest thyself God. And here, you know, And this is awesome too, and I don't even know if I realized this before, how explicit that is. They say right there, why are you stoning me? Because of blasphemy. Well, what does that mean? What's blasphemy? Because thou being a man makest thyself God. Makest thyself God. The Jews acknowledge that Jesus claimed to be God explicitly. Okay? That's wonderful. Now, so I and my Father are one. That's what I'm going to focus on, but also I should make note of the end of that too. I and my Father are one. And you know, I need to go over the Trinity too, and this kind of collides with all this stuff too. Like I said, when I talk about the divine nature, I might go into the human nature. Also, when I talk about the person of Jesus, I'll be going into the Trinity, and all this kind of mixes together, but they all need to be looked at separately, and all these little intricacies, and it all needs to be understood, you know. And sometimes we go over the same verses over and over again, but we mention different things that we can learn from them. But, you know, we should never say that the Trinity is three separate persons in one being, okay? They're not separate, okay? They're united, okay? I and my Father are one, you know? I and my Father are equal, okay? He never says that I and my Father are separate, okay? So they're distinct persons, okay? The Father is Son, or the Father is distinct from the Son, the Son's distinct from the Father is distinct from the Holy Spirit is distinct from the Son, distinct from the Father, etc. They're all distinct from one another, okay? Like, you know, Jesus, or God sent His Son, okay? The Father sent the Son, all right? And so the Son sent the Holy Spirit, okay? So you see, they're distinct in many different ways. That's just an example. They're distinct, but they're united. They're not separate, okay? And so sometimes we think that these are just semantics. It's just, you know, but you're really, if you say they are separate, then you're teaching something else, okay? And it's not going to agree with Scripture. So it's important that we understand that they're distinct, but they're united. But anyways, we're talking about the deity of Jesus Christ. We're talking about the deity of the second person in the Godhead. We're talking about His divine nature. And we're talking about how the Jews acknowledged that Jesus claimed to be God. Well, He said, I and my Father are one. Okay. And then, so I want to put that too. Maybe I'll just go up here. Where am I at on the board? Thou being a man. How do they say that? Thou being a man makest thyself God. Okay, that's what the Jews said that He said. We'll give a arrow to there. Okay. Because I think that's important to note there. That really gets the gist of what this whole section is. So Jesus said, my Father and I are one. This is not only in counsel and will, as John 17, verse 11 and 22, and believers are said to be of one heart, in Acts chapter 4, verse 32. Okay, so we see that, you know, the Son and the Father are one in counsel and in will, and believers are said to be of one heart with one another. But this is more than that. He is one with the Father in nature, in power, and essence. For it is plain that our Savior here ascribes the preservation of the sheep not to the will, but to the power of His Father. None is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. And this is what is being spoken of in this passage. If you go here and you read the verses prior to this. This is where he's talking about how the sheep are in the Father's hand, and no one can pluck them out of my Father's hand. And it is plain by what follows that the Jews understood that our Savior... let's see here. Okay, I guess... Yeah, and it is plain by what follows that the Jews understood... Thus understood our Savior. Okay. I don't know, that doesn't sound right, whatever. Well, they understood that him saying that he makes himself equal with God. So they understood when Jesus said, I and my Father are one, he wasn't talking about just in counsel or in will, but in essence, in power, okay, in divinity. Because they said, you make yourself to be God. Okay? So... And I mean, we should see that, you know, he said no one can pluck you out of the Father's hand, and no one can pluck you out of my hand. I think that's what he says. I should go there. I'll just go there. Let's go to John chapter 10. I wonder how far back I go here. John chapter 10. John chapter 10. And with the verse, passages 30 and 33. Yeah. Yeah, basically it starts kind of in verse 25. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me, but ye believe not, because ye are not of my sheep. As I said unto you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life. I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Okay. No one can pluck them out of the Father's hand because of the power of the Father. And Jesus says the same thing about himself, that no one can pluck them out of Jesus' hand, the Son. And he says, I and my Father are one. So we are one in power, okay? In divine power. So, this is... wonder how I want to say this. How can I write this here? Well, maybe I'll just squeeze it in up here. Okay. This is the Jews acknowledged Jesus claimed to be God. Okay, and if you got any questions about that, you could certainly go to John chapter 10, verse 30 through 33, where they say, Thou being a man makest thyself God. So, the Jews acknowledge Jesus claimed to be God. Now, we're going to go on to the next section, where Jesus claims to be God himself. We can more explicitly see that being said. And so, I hope that there will be enough room on here. I just want to continue to add to this and leave it all up if I can. And we'll just draw a line here. Okay. And we'll say, Jesus claimed to be God. I hope we're still recording. Jesus claimed to be God. Now, I'm mentioning again John chapter 5, verse 18, but also John 10, verse 36. And they kind of say the same things. So, John 5, 18, and 10, 36. Now, John 5:18 again says, therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he had not only broken the Sabbath, but said also that Jesus was his Father, making himself equal with God. Now in John chapter 10, verse 36, we see it says, say ye of him whom the Father hath sanctified and sent into the world, thou blasphemest, because I said I am the Son of God. Okay, so this is Jesus speaking. Again, he said, say ye of him, speaking of himself, whom the Father hath sanctified, the Father sanctified the Son, and sent into the world, thou blasphemest, because I said I am the Son of God. So he says, I am the Son of God. And so we see when Jesus uses this, he's speaking of his divine nature, okay? It's not just in the sense that all of us believers who believe in Jesus become a child of God, a son or a daughter of God, because we're adopted into the family, so to say. But Jesus is the Son by nature, okay? So this expression, I am the Son of God, this, the Jews, evidently understood as the same as saying that he was equal with God. This expression, and I just want to go back over in John chapter 5 verse 18, they said, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. And so if he says that God is his Father, then in essence, you know, he's also saying that he is the Son of God. So he doesn't, that he might not say, I am the Son of God, but every time he says that God is his Father, he's saying that he is the Son. So we can see that in that verse too. But the Jews evidently understood this the same as saying that he is equal with God. This expression he had often applied to himself. The meaning of this place may be thus expressed. You charge me with blasphemy. The foundation of that charge is the use of the name God, or the Son of God, applied to myself. Yet that same term is applied in Scripture to magistrates. Okay, the use of it there shows that it is rightly to apply it to those who sustain important offices. So I think this could be talking about, like, in the Scriptures and Psalms or whatever we see where, like, judges, it says, you know, you say ye are gods. And so it kind of means, you know, it doesn't mean in divinity. It just means that they are kind of like rulers in a way. It doesn't mean that they're divine. So he's saying, you know, this is used in Scripture. We've seen this. And so, but when I use it, all of a sudden you're saying blasphemy. So especially you Jews ought not to attempt to found a charge of blasphemy on the application of a word to the Messiah, which your own Scripture is applied to all magistrates. Now, we may notice from this that, one, Jesus did not deny that he meant to apply the term to himself, okay? Also, he did not deny that it was properly applied to him, okay? So, he didn't deny that he didn't mean it in a sense that he is equal in nature with the Father. And he did not deny that it implied that he was God. That's what I just said, basically. But he affirmed only that they were inconsistent and were not authorized to bring a charge of blasphemy for the application of the name to himself. So he's pointing out the inconsistency from the Jews or the Pharisees or the scribes. And he doesn't say that it was wrongly applied to him when they said that he was equal with God, that he was claiming to be God. Okay, he doesn't deny that. So, but this is how we understand this. When he says he's the Son of God, he's talking about his divine nature. Okay, but so maybe a little bit confusing there, but hope you get that. And looks like there will be enough room on the board. Now here's another one. This is... Okay, I forgot to mention this too. Stoning was the penalty for blasphemy. In Leviticus chapter 24, verse 16, and he that blasphemeth the name of the Lord shall surely be put to death, and all the congregation shall certainly stone him. as well the stranger as he that is born in the land, when he blasphemeth the name of the Lord shall be put to death. So stoning was the penalty for blasphemy, and basically every time Jesus said things like this, they wanted to stone him. And we saw explicitly in John chapter 10, verse 33-33, that they wanted to stone him for blasphemy because he, being a man, makes himself God. Okay. Now, Matthew chapter 12, verse 6. Matthew chapter 12, verse 6, "But I say unto you that in this place is one greater than the temple." One greater than the temple. Man, that's really messy. Oh, gosh. One greater than the temple. Christ's argument is that if the temple and the service of it excuse the priests from blame and doing things in it on the Sabbath day, which otherwise might not be done, then much more might his presence, who was greater than the temple, excuse his disciples from blame in this action of rubbing and eating ears of corn, which was done to satisfy hunger, and to render them more capable of performing their ministerial function, and which was of more importance than the service of the priests. So he's greater than the temple, and he says, following this, that God desires mercy and not sacrifice. And so basically, God, Jesus is divine. He has the authority to set the rules, to say what's right and what's wrong. And in this sense, basically, you know, he's saying that, you know, this is, that what they're doing is good, okay? It's not wrong for them to eat these ears of corn and take them on the Sabbath day. And he has the power to sanctify. So this is pretty explicit, again, you know, one greater than the temple. Pretty explicit that Jesus is claiming to be God. And this one's pretty equal to that, which I think this one's a really great one too, for proving the deity of Christ in Scripture. Matthew chapter 12, verse 8. So, and this is, I guess, just a couple verses later from what we just said. And Jesus says, "For the Son of Man," which is to express his human nature, "is Lord even of the Sabbath day." Okay? Lord of the Sabbath day, basically, is what he said. Or we'll just say Lord of the Sabbath. Okay? So Jesus said he is Lord of the Sabbath. So what does that mean besides, you know, Jesus saying that he is God? Because in Exodus chapter 20, verse 2, before God's given the Ten Commandments, I guess, to Moses, he says, "I am the Lord, I am the Lord, Lord of the Sabbath. I am the Lord, thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage." And then, six verses later, Exodus chapter 20, verse 8, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy." I am the Lord, remember the Sabbath day. Jesus said, "I am the Lord of the Sabbath." The argument in Luke has it this way, or the argument in Luke is in Luke chapter 6, verse 5. That's the parallel passage here. Mark has it in Mark chapter 2, verse 27 and 28. And in Mark, he says, "And he said unto them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man the Sabbath. Therefore the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath." Now some interpreters make these two arguments. One, the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. Therefore it is in my power to dispense with this action of my disciples, though it had been contrary to the letter of the law, or rather, therefore it is in my power to interpret the law, which I myself made. And also, number two, the Sabbath is made for man, not man for the Sabbath. A law made for the good of another bindeth not, in such cases where the observation of it would be evidently for his harm and ruin. The law of the Sabbath was made for the good of man, that he might have a solemn time, in which he should be under an obligation to pay his homage unto God. This must not be so interpreted as it would tend to the destruction of a man. So, I mean, the disciples were hungry, you know, and they needed food for strength and stuff. So in this case, for them to pluck the corn and eat it on the Sabbath day, it's excusable. It's for the better. So God didn't make laws to hurt man. It's for the better of man, okay? God always knows what's best for us, even though it's not always maybe the easy thing for us to do. Maybe it's not always something, you know, we're comfortable with or what we want to do because of our flesh. And, you know, I realized that when I got saved, when I came to the Lord. You know, that was one of the things. I said, you know, look at all these mistakes that I've made in my life. You know, a lot of them, if I would have just listened to God and not done things my way, then they would have been better. And I realized that, you know, that the things that God wants us to do, doesn't want us to do, it's for our benefit. It's for our best. And that doesn't mean that being a Christian, that life is easy. That doesn't mean, you know, the health and wealth gospel. Okay, because there is persecution. There's suffering, you know, even greater for Christians. But there's a lot of suffering and going off the path and doing things our own way too. You know, so when we suffer for Christ, we can still have peace with knowing that, you know, we're doing what God wants us to do. But when we suffer because of our own actions that go against God, we don't have that peace. And, you know, it's worse knowing that, you know, we caused this and that we did wrong. And yeah. But Jesus said, "Lord, I'm Lord of the Sabbath." And I'll continue here. "I find interpreters divided about the term Son of Man. Some think that it is not to be interpreted as usually in the gospel concerning Christ, but of ordinary men, and that men's lordship over the Sabbath day is proved by the subserviency of it to his good, to which end also it was ordained. But certainly that is both dangerous and unscriptural interpretation, dangerous to give man a lordship over a moral law, for it is very improper to call any lord of a thing, because he hath the use of it, and it is for his advantage. I cannot see, but we may as well make man lord of the whole Ten Commandments, as of one of them. Unscriptural, for though our Savior useth this term more than 80 times in the Gospel, yet he always useth it with relation to himself, the Son of Man, speaking of his human nature, never with any reference to mere man. Neither is there any necessity to understand it otherwise here. Christ affirming himself Lord of the Sabbath spake properly enough to the Pharisees' quarrel, for it must needs then follow that he had power to dispense with the observation of it at practical times, and much more to give a true and right interpretation of the law concerning it." So I thought it was interesting to note that. So some might say that Jesus said the Son of Man is the Lord of the Sabbath. And they say, well, he's saying that basically all men are Lord of the Sabbath in some way. And then he's saying, well, if they say that, then we can say in some way men are Lord of the Ten Commandments. All men are Lord of the Ten Commandments. You know, that sounds very bad. Okay, so, you know, one thing leads to another, and it's like a slippery slope we're going down here. So the best way to understand it is the way that it's meant to be understood. The Son of Man, Jesus, was referencing to himself. He's not referencing to humanity, okay? He's referencing to himself. But he's referencing to himself making note of his human nature. That's all it is, you know. He referenced to himself as the Son of God. He referenced to himself as the Son of Man. He referenced to himself as one greater than the temple. He referenced to himself as Lord of the Sabbath. You know, he is Lord of the Sabbath. And so, yeah. Now, if somebody denies the deity of Christ, if somebody denies the Trinity, basically they're denying the deity of Christ, unless they're teaching polytheism, they're teaching multiple gods, they say, well, Jesus was a god, the Father was a god, they're separate gods. You know, that's not what the Bible teaches. But I've recently had a debate with somebody who came into the chat room, kjvchat.com, and they were denying the Trinity and everything, and so, you know, I tried to make them answer these verses and stuff, and they couldn't come up with anything. They tried to say that Jesus and the Son and the Father were separate entities. Okay, no, they're not separate entities. They're separate, or they're distinct persons. Okay, they're distinct persons. They're not separate anything. Okay, they're united. And we see that, you know, he says, I and my Father are one, I'm equal, my Father. So, they are not separate entities. They are distinct persons, united, in one being, that is, the Godhead, God. They share divinity. But if somebody denies the Trinity, somebody denies the deity of Christ, bring them to these verses. Say, you know, well then what did Jesus mean when he said, my Father worketh hitherto, and why did the Jews claim that he was blaspheming? Why did the Jews say that he was making himself equal to God? That's how they understood it. You know, why don't you understand it as that? Jesus said before Abraham was, I am. What did he mean by that? If Jesus wasn't divine, if he didn't mean that he existed somehow before Abraham, what did he mean? You know, why did he say, I am, when God said, I am that I am? Why was he using that similar language? Why didn't he say, before Abraham, I was? Why did he say, I am? Why did he use the present? Okay, why did he say, I and my Father are one? What did he mean by that? What did he mean, you know, by saying that he was the Son of God? What did he mean by saying that he was greater than one, than the temple, or Lord of the Sabbath, you know? If they're going to deny the Trinity, deny the deity of Christ, they have to have good answers for all of these, and much more. This is only the beginning. This is only part one of a huge study. It'll probably be like 100 pages if you print it out on the website when I'm done, okay? And of course, I'll go through it and refine it. I want to make it short, but I want to make it extensive too, and I really want to hit these points to where we can fully understand these, and we have arguments to back these up. Back up what Jesus meant when he said these things. Okay, people will try to come up with saying that Jesus meant something else, but you'll see that it won't work. It can't work. So, there's a lot more to this. These are good verses to meditate on, to think about. You know, the Son is eternal. The Son is equal in attributes with the Father. The Son is omnipresent. Omniscient, he knows all things, he's all powerful, he's omnipotent. And, you know, I went over some of how the three persons in the Godhead share attributes, they have equal attributes. And so much more needs to be said about the Trinity, but I don't know. I like this study, hope you appreciate it. And now I can continue and work on the next part. You know, I can just say some of the other evidences to see that Jesus was divine, that Jesus had a divine nature, is that he has divine names used in reference to God. We'll look at those. He, you know, the expression, I am, and Jesus is worshipped. Divine worship is ascribed to him. He possesses the qualities and properties of deity, and we'll look at that. We already have, but I may go over that again a little deeper. Divine offices are ascribed to him. Divine attributes are possessed by him. You know, we'll look at the Christophanies, how, you know, the angel of the Lord in the Old Testament is Jesus. And the self-consciousness of Jesus regarding his own person and work. So there's much, much more we'll go over. All about the deity of Christ. And so when someone says that Jesus wasn't God, they have a lot to deal with, and we'll see that. And so not only do I want you to have the verses and the phrases and things that were said, but, you know, I want you to have more and more arguments to back these things up. Okay, so the Jews, you know, Jesus isn't God. Okay, well, the Jews acknowledge that Jesus claimed to be God, and Jesus claimed to be God himself explicitly in the Scriptures, you know. And they'll say, well, there's never a place where Jesus said, I am God, so therefore Jesus is not God. I'm sorry, that doesn't work, okay? That's just ignorance, okay? You know, you could say, well, there's never a place in Scripture where Jesus says, I am not God. Okay, so you could just come back with the same thing, and you see how stupid that argument is. Okay, so let's have arguments that are based on truth and, you know, consideration, and, you know, use our intellect and really understand Jesus and the Godhead and the Scriptures. So, dear God, thank you for this day, this wonderful day. The weather's getting nicer. Praise you, God. We always praise you. Thank you for sending your Son, Lord. Thank you for your Holy Spirit, God, which all believers are indwelt by. You are so wonderful, God. You're so merciful, Lord. Help us to have mercy on others, Lord. Please forgive us for our sins, God. We need your forgiveness always. Help us to stay focused on you and your word. Help us to be bold, to give witness of what your Son did on the cross, Lord, to spread the gospel. Lord, we need your help, and, you know, we can't do anything outside of your grace, God. And we understand that. Help us to be grateful and thankful more every day for even the smallest things, just to be alive, just to be, you know, the fact that we're saved. Help us, you know, we need to rejoice in that, and we do rejoice in that, and we do thank you and give you praise now. And I just pray that whoever watched this, whoever listened to this, will get a better understanding of your Son, of the Godhead, and see that Jesus is divine, shares divinity with you, with the Father. And we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So thanks, guys. Hopefully I'll get more out soon. Go to the website, acceptyoubeconverted.com. Go to Sound Doctrine, Jesus, Person and Natures, and then you can see the Deity of Christ. I'll be working on that. You know, go to kjvforum.com. Go to kjvchat.com. The menu's up there. If you visit from the desktop computer, you can see everything that I'm working on. There's a whole lot of subjects, and I'm going to be bouncing back and forth between different things. But this Deity of Christ is something I already have printed out, a lot of arguments. I'm just going to go through, refine them, and I should be able to get through this a little bit quicker than other things that I'm working on. And this is very important. This is very important. It's going to help us to understand a lot. And, you know, there's a lot of false doctrines concerning the persons and nature of Christ, and Mormonism, and Jehovah's Witnesses, and other religions. You know, Islam rejects that Jesus was divine. And so even Islam, you know, so just learning the deity of Christ, it gives us a big step in understanding and refuting these false religions as well. So, and I can go into them more detail, how they would interpret these verses, but you'll see it doesn't work. So we know that Jesus is God. Jesus is the Son of God. And anyways, thanks for watching, and God bless.